Well, good morning to everyone. We welcome you here at the Rivers Church for the 2017 commencement of the class of Community Christian College. Let's give them all a hand. This is a great accomplishment, and we want to recognize and make sure that we do not leave anything out. Right now, I'd like to introduce the president of the college, Josh Taransky.
Good morning. On behalf of Community Christian College, we want to welcome you, and we appreciate you coming and supporting and celebrating the graduation of these students. It's been a great couple of years, and you guys have worked hard. I'm very proud of you and excited to celebrate your graduation. Let's pray together. Lord, we are so grateful for your faithfulness in our lives, that you give us strength when we are tired, that you give us hope, you give us a vision for the future, and you direct our steps. We are grateful for our families and the people that you put in our lives that will support us along the way. We are so grateful for those that are here, recognizing and celebrating with us this the momentous occasion of this graduation. God, would you be in our midst, and would you inspire and encourage each one of these students from this day forward? Would you continue this good work that you've done in them, the preparation and the investment that they've made in their own learning? We pray, God, that you would use them in the world as fruitful individuals. Open up doors for them, provide for their needs, bless their relationships. We do commend them to you and ask for your presence over this ceremony. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Students, try to squeeze in real tight. We've got to get Joseph. We can't leave him outside. Yeah, move on over. Thank you. Go ahead, Joseph. You're part of this. Well, today we're going to be blessed. We have a guest worship leader, someone who's known in the area, but we're very thankful. I'd like to welcome this one time to lead us in worship. The words and music are actually the words are in your program, so we'll sing along with us. Josh Hawley.
Ten thousand. Thank you. privilege of being in his life for about 6 years, watching him grow up and play the piano, and it's just remarkable. Isn't that crazy how good he is? Thank you, Jonathan, for blessing me today. That was beautiful. Let's just keep worshiping our Lord. Let's thank him for the love that we have. The no separation that we have with our Father.
Nothing can separate.
Yeah.
raise your hand and let everyone know that you're here in the house. We have board members, your board members. Our chairman of the board, Don Idle. And you know, all that's good, but without Don in the back making it all work together, we wouldn't have any sound. So I want to you know, when we were talking about who would know this class enough to bring the message to them? David Zamora and I were talking about it, and we came to an agreement, the same person, the same moment. We know who we want, and we hope the students would want. May I introduce today's speaker, our own professor, Dustin Guerrero.
It's quite an honor to be here. When Dr. Avalos asked me to speak today, I was very hesitant. I felt that whatever I could offer to this your wonderful achievement would seem merely inadequate. To be honest, I didn't feel worthy or ready to offer some words of significance that should stay with you as you leave Community Christian College. So I didn't want to invoke some cheesy platitude that you could buy at Barnes & Noble with a cat dangling from a branch, like, hang in there, buddy. And I also didn't think it would be appropriate to try to give you the greatest thing ever. I honestly, I didn't know what to say. I've had most of you in my class, and there were times you might have considered me the greatest professor ever, especially when I dismissed an assignment or a test. One student a few years ago used to always come in saying, did the Lord speak to you today? Because I've been praying. Are we stopping that test? So, often or not, I'm sure there's times you quietly cursed me when I returned your jackdaw and said, this is not a primary source. So we've laughed. Sometimes you've laughed too much trying to get an A. But that's okay, I know I have lame jokes. And some of you are probably still seriously wondering if Dread Pirate Roberts is seriously a historical figure. He was a famous character on Princess Bride, and oftentimes I invoked his name to try to confuse people. So, whatever our interactions and your feelings towards myself or my class, I hope that you always understood that I cared for you guys. I hope you realize that while I wished you to submit, I really wished that to help you submit the foundation of your political philosophy and a deeper understanding of history, I considered helping you grow as a Christian scholar one of the greatest endeavors I could have pursued. With that in mind, I tried to construct in my address something worthy of the occasion. After about 10 different drafts of the greatest commencement address my living room will ever hear, I changed my thoughts completely and because it just felt empty and inadequate. So after more prayer, I finally felt the Lord saying, what would you wish you had heard when you're graduating from college? And to me, that's simple. There are three things I wish I would have understood when I left college. One, don't wait to do what you love. Two, don't be afraid of changing your dreams, your goals. And three, always, always, always seek God first. So with these three objectives, I will try to briefly put my thoughts together. I understand it's hard to think of my words before you because most of you are thinking about the world before you. But I feel like I've got to give you something to chew on. I can't just say good luck and sit down, although that would be ideal. But this is a special occasion where everybody gathered here wishes to honor your hard work and your dedication to your academic career. To be here before you at this time, on this day, at this podium, in this circumstance, is truly a high honor. And the significance of the occasion demands that we take some time to offer some thoughts to encourage you on the years ahead. So, like a piece of bubblicious gum, I want you to chew on these words as you travel through life's road. And maybe when your bubble gum bursts during the challenges you will face, you will remember my words of encouragement as you pick the gooey, sticky pieces off your face. So first, don't wait to do what you love. Philippians 1:6 says, being confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will be will be able to complete it the day of Christ Jesus. I really wish that someone would have told me that when I had graduated college. After college, I did what I loved. I moved to Washington, D.C., worked as a congressman. I worked for a congressman, not as a congressman. For a congressman, toured the East Coast, worked in some great ministries, and in general had a great experience. And that's all appropriate. When I realized I needed to come home and start focusing on some career, it's like I live in a stealth mode. I used to love to act, and I put together an acting troupe in college. When I came home, I kept thinking, I'll do that at church sometimes. I'll put together an acting troupe. But, you know, we'll go minister when I have some more time. I'll tell you, I'll do it when I have people that want to do it with me. I'll do it when, essentially came down to I think I was too scared. What if it didn't go that well? You know, I was technically grown up, and no one's there to pick up after me if I fail. And so I'm sure that if you went back and asked your parents, they probably would have said that they've had those fears as well. Hopefully by now you're realizing that they are smarter than you once thought they were, particularly in junior high, high school. You know, oh, mother. Oh, father. All humans spend so much time living, and we forget to do what we love, because we love, but what we love is often not essential, and it sometimes is scary. It's like when you're on a budget, you're simply buying top ramen rather than a juicy steak, even when you can afford it. Obviously, when I say to do what you love, I'm not talking about sitting at home eating pizza in your PJs, watching a movie. I'm talking mostly about ministry or some form of giving back. We all have passions in our life that we love. I'm talking about volunteering, making a difference. Most of you came to the school because of the Christian emphasis. And so I'm trusting that you are committed to making a difference. And many of you have areas where you love to serve God and use Him. Or allow God to use you, sorry. So do it. Don't wait for anything else, just do it. I mean, finish your last papers. Get that done. Don't dismiss your college classes. But do it. Don't make up excuses for not engaging in ministry. Many of you guys know I love soccer. It took me a long time to actually get into coaching, and I felt like I could offer something. But it was scary. It was uncomfortable. But obviously, I wasn't spending any time preaching, but I felt like at the end of it, I was a positive coach that could make a difference. So I had to get out and do it. Many presidents have even been black Sunday school teachers. Benjamin Harrison, Richard Nixon, Jimmy Carter, they didn't do it while they were president, but before and after, they were very involved in their church, making a difference, because that is what is important to them, and that's what they love. So if you love it, and it can make a difference, do it. Don't wait for it. Second, don't be afraid to change your goals. Daniel 3:17-18 is about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and they're about to be thrown in the fiery furnace. And Nebuchadnezzar says, do what I ask you to do, or else you'll die. And they said, you know what? I know that God can save us. But in verse 18, it says, even if he doesn't, it doesn't mean he's not God. And we all have dreams, and the world loves to judge us by those dreams. In fact, I had a couple of girls in high school, when I was in high school, their big planned trip, their dream trip after graduation was to drive to Hawaii. Obviously, dreams change. My favorite story about this, when reality hits in, you know, halfway through. There's also a boy who dreamed of trading his beat-up car for a sports car after graduation. And his dad promised that if he could do three things, he would give him that sports car. But first, he must do these things. First, seriously study Jesus, Paul, the early church fathers, get at least to be average, and to cut his hair. So graduation came and was coming, and the son came up, Dad, have you seen my grades? And the son said, yes, son, very proud of you. Straight A's, wow, impressive. He said, Dad, I've been studying at heart about Jesus and the early church fathers. I've learned about their philosophies, their doctrines, and I took seriously their teachings. I try to model my life after Paul, and I hope to be mightily used by God. Yes, son, I've seen that. I'm very proud of you. So, Dad, what about the car? Father looked at him and said, well, son, I asked you three things. You still lack one. You still need to cut your hair. The son looked at his father with an earnest and sincere face, responded, yes, Dad. But when I was studying John the Baptist, St. Thomas Aquinas, Paul, the disciples, even Jesus, I realized they made a difference in the world and they all had long hair. Therefore, I'm trying to model my life after them. And so if they didn't cut their hair and still change the world, why should I? The father looked at the son with equal sincerity and earnestness. He said, "Son, you are right. They didn't cut their hair, and there is something to be said about that. However, you missed one thing from all this." "What's that, Dad?" "They walked everywhere. Now go cut your hair." So for you who are about to step out on your life with dreams, there's some of you going to four-year college, some of you guys are going to take some time to think about it. Whatever your vision of the future might look like, tomorrow is the next step in your adult life. Or it could be in August. Or, you know, it might be when mom and dad show up at the door with the boxes saying, "When will we see you next?" So, for my friend, it was when he went to college, he had to imagine his dreams because his parents didn't lock him. They changed the locks. They moved to North Dakota. And he said that was quite traumatic. But whatever the next step is for you, you are all trying to fulfill some dream. Some of you have known what your dream is since you traded in your bath towel and used for a cape for a slide ruler, or you specific class changed your perspective, or maybe you think, "I need another year," but your dream is coming. And oftentimes our dreams are about who we are, who we're going to marry, where we're going to live, how much money we're going to make. And those dreams are great, but they're born in youthful mindsets built upon fantastic planes of the imagination. But they fuel our hopes, our passion, our possibilities, and they're constructed with a limited understanding of the future and flawed view of the world. And many of our world loves to judge us based upon the construction of the dream we told them when we were young. So don't be embarrassed as the reality starts to cause you to rethink your dream. I really believe that I want to work in government, and I had a good start working with a congressman from Maryland. But as many of my class know, a trip to Gettysburg with a professor from the National War College changed my perspective. I realized that it wasn't enough to just enjoy history as a pastime. I needed to teach that, and my dream was radically altered on that day. Very few will know exactly the moment your dream has changed, but there will come times, and don't be afraid to change your dreams. John Adams is my favorite person who changed his dream. He hoped to be a successful Boston lawyer. He wanted to teach his children to be lawyers, his sons to be lawyers as well. But when the revolution came, he started to rethink his life. He later wrote, "I must study politics and war, that my sons have the liberty to study mathematics and philosophy." He went on to say that his children should study mathematics and philosophy so their children can study art and beauty. Did you catch the nuance? He was explaining why he no longer was content with simply being a lawyer. His dream has changed because the world he lived in had changed with him. I'm confident if you turned around to your parents or talked to your professors, they could explain this to you as well. When you're young, your dreams are slightly selfish. And then you meet someone or something happens to change your perspective. And I'm guaranteed that watching you graduate today is a fulfillment of your parents' dreams. Maybe not the dreams they had when they were young, but the dreams that they've had as they've grown up to temper their visions. George H.W. Bush once asked, "What was the greatest moment of your life? Was it when you were inaugurated president?" He said, "That was pretty good. But it's when I got to see two of my sons inaugurated as governors and one inaugurated as president." His dream had changed because his reality had changed. Our world doesn't understand this. They judge your accomplishment by the ability to live up to your dream. Don't be afraid to allow your dreams to evolve, for a lack of a better term, with you, so that when you're forming the kind of person the Lord wants you to be, your dreams can change with that. And third, always, always, always seek God first. Matthew 6:31-33 says, "Therefore take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewith shall we be clothed? For all these do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows what you need. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." Black Friday is a fun day for many people. My cousins go out nowadays it extends into Thursday. They start on Thursday. But they go out and they have a good time, and that's their enjoyment. But we all have heard the horror stories of Black Friday. where people are trampled and different things. It's not the getting the Blu-ray on discount or the free TV the first 100 people that is wrong. But there is something to be said about people that only focus on those things. Abraham Lincoln once said that somewhere we are desperately selfish. The Bible says somewhere that we are desperately selfish, and I think we don't need necessarily the Bible to discover that. And that's true. We look around the world and we see that people are selfish. Even people who don't know God can recognize selfishness. And so it's easy in our society to ignore that. Pleasure and comfort are everywhere in our society. I was out to dinner the other night with a family of four, and they all had their devices focusing on that, ignoring the people around them. But we shouldn't just make our lives simply about comfort and pleasure. Furthermore, we also shouldn't make our lives about getting things. I was at the NFL Experience in San Diego the day before the Super Bowl many years ago, where my favorite Raiders bombed out miserably. That's another side. Please don't judge me by my Raiders. I am still a Christian, I promise you. So, but I went to the Pepsi tent, and there's this guy with a mullet from the 80s. Party in the front, business in the front, but party in the back. Wearing a sleeveless shirt, dancing around on stage, just trying to get the crowd going, asking people who wants free stuff. And people start jumping and screaming. And when I was younger, I could jump and scream with the rest of them, get on jumbotrons, like, hey, look at me. And it was at that moment I decided that because what he was throwing out were keychains. And here I am acting like a fool for a keychain. It's the want of stuff. I've never done that before. I go to the Galaxy Game all the time and throw t-shirts like, so I can't do that anymore because of that moment of revelation. They're nothing. Do you want to pursue that? Is that who you want to be? Someone who goes crazy for free stuff. But stuff and pleasure, comfort and peace are not necessarily bad unless you're focusing on that. And in fact, it says in verse 31, the Gentiles seek what to eat, what to drink, what to clothe you. But God didn't say necessarily those things are bad. Because when he goes on, he says, God says, seek God first, and those things will also be added to you. Our society says material wealth is an accomplishment. And Jesus said, no. Material wealth could be a byproduct of following. It's not the accomplishment itself. What's the difference? It's like celebrating Valentine's Day without the love. Oh, give me. Christmas without Christ. If we remove the reason why we celebrate, we are more akin to a pack of dogs fighting over one bone. Or Black Friday sales. So, I'm kidding. Removing the good from the world encourages selfishness. So if we don't seek God first, we are just, that's all we have left, is our selfishness. Even U.S. presidents have been seeking the Lord in their ways. Abraham Lincoln said on September 9, 1864, then regard to this great book, the Bible. I have but to say, it is the best gift of God, or it is the best gift God has given to men. All the good the Savior gave the world was communicated through the Bible. But we could not know right and wrong. All things most desirable for men's welfare here and after are to be found portrayed in it. Ronald Reagan said, my daily prayer is that God will help me to use this position as president to serve him. So seek God first, and all of these things will be added to you. So as we finish here today, and you go on to the next step of your life, I hope that that something I said here today may have encouraged or challenged you. It may be simple stuff. I know they're elementary. They're not really hard theological discussions, and sometimes you might think, I've heard that before. But I think the greatest lesson I've learned in life is that the greatest lessons that I need to learn are things that I already knew. It's just, I need to be reminded of them sometimes. So class of 2017, don't wait to do what you love. Don't be afraid to change or adjust your dreams, and always, always, always seek God first. I'll leave you with a blessing from Pope Francis, which he recently offered over the Italian, two Italian soccer teams playing for the Italian championship. I changed a few words to make it fit, but when I read it, I was like, this really works. You are considered champions, and every match or day is a battle of balance, understanding of oneself, respect of the rules. This is what I wish for you all, to be examples of loyalty, honesty, harmony, and humanity. So go with God. Thank you.
Guiding me and giving me the hope that I so do understand today. To conclude, none of this could be possible with the inspiring love of Christ and His Holy Spirit. He has been the focus point of this entire journey. I'm so appreciative that I could receive my associate's degree in liberal arts in the surroundings of His people and their love for Him. So with that, I stand before you now, humble and encouraged to continue and honor God in all I do. Thank you.
We just began on our campus in Downey, and I had her first year, and as she said in that class, she goes, "Well, I'm going back to school. I don't know if I'm in my element and I can do it." You did it. Our next student reflection will be Nicole Jacobs.
My journey as a college student has been a rigorous one with lots and lots of work, but yet I have enjoyed the journey. Not only have I grown mentally, but I have grown in my confidence to overcome obstacles. And my confidence of being a great student in my academics and in my career choice has also grown. Through my experience as a college student at Community Christian College, I have been surrounded by a team of professors who have pushed me to work hard and to use my mind like I have never had before attending this college. I have been blessed by this college, and the fact that there are fantastic faculty to help me, it just made that journey even more pleasurable. Through my journey as a college student, I have grown so much in my walk with the Lord. When I came to enroll at Community Christian College, I had been a college dropout and had not been in school for a little over 10 years. But God still pushed me to enroll, and He gave me the peace and strength I needed to continue on with the enrollment process. God showed me that He believed in me, and He has taught me to enjoy the journey of opening up my mind to learning new things from His perspective in order to reach educational heights that I have never reached before. The journey for me included the start of new classes each quarter, and with that came the excitement of learning many new things. Each professor is unique in their own way, and with the differences in their teaching styles, I was able to grow tremendously in my college academics. Some of the classes that were most memorable for me were Introduction to Visual and Performing Arts, Introduction to the Old Testament and New Testament, Personal Finance, Human Civilization, Western World, and English 205. Some of the reasons these classes have had such a positive impact on my life are through art. This class, which was taught by Professor Avalos, Ms. Professor Avalos, I was able to express through art such a hurt and pain that I have held on for so long in my heart about losing my mom as an infant, thus helping me start the process of healing. I have also gained so much insight on how and why art is used in many different forms. Human Civilization, Western World was by far one of the toughest classes I have taken at Community Christian College. How I got an A+ as my final grade for that class can only be by the grace of God. Professor Dustin, whether he knows it or not, has had such a positive impact on my life and academic journey. He did not have to, but out of the kindness of his heart, he chose to write me an uplifting email stating how proud and pleased he was with all of my hard work, and also gave me a positive push telling me to never give up in my college studies. This class has pushed me to work harder than any other class, and it really truly helped me to appreciate the outcome that comes from hard work. This class has shown me that I'm stronger and I'm smarter than I thought I was. And after passing that class, I felt so much more confident in my role as an academic student here at CCC. And last but not least, the class I will speak about next is English 205, taught by Professor Wagner. Wagner is tough, and yet through her platform of academic curriculum, I was shown just how deep the depths of my writing skills can go. I was also introduced to one of my now favorite books called Angel Lover, as well as some other really interesting reads that I would have never picked up on my own. Through this class, I experienced reads from a genre that I normally would have never picked up. But through these different reads, I was able to see the power and love of God in a whole new outlet. And I was surprisingly shown that I can enjoy new and different genres when my perspective of them has changed. This journey as a college student is to now being a graduating student has taught me many lessons that will forever be with me long after my graduation. This journey has taught me self-discipline and the meaning of hard work. Being an online student means it literally was just me and the Lord working it out. And I had made the decision that I was going to work really hard and not work halfway. I chose to work harder than I ever have before in my life, and I have learned to let go of laziness, especially on the days that I just did not feel like doing anything. Being here at graduation has so many mixed emotions attached to it, and I almost do not want the journey to end. But I know that having future goals for myself academically helps me to move forward confidently with my head held high. I have enjoyed this journey, and I hope that the rest of the graduates of 2017 have enjoyed this journey just as much as I have, if not more. I give a salute to all of you, and I want to say that I am proud of you because you all made it. Congratulations. Being able to give a commencement speech for all of the college graduates is something I never thought I would do, and I want to say thank you all for being a part of this journey and being here with me today. Thank you.
I finished my first class and I passed. I don't remember what the grade was, but I passed, and that was all that mattered to me. I was ready to go back, and I began setting goals for myself. Even with small doubts in the back of my mind, I told myself that I would work harder in both schools so that I would finish high school early. Fast forwarding, I did that. I completed the goals I set, and I eventually took the responsibility of 7 classes for high school and 3, maybe 4 classes here at CCC. And I finished high school semester early on December 8th of 2015. And I walked with my peers a few months later in the summer of 2016. And here I stand before you, class of 2017 of CCC, to encourage you that doubts can be conquered because God is on our side if we trust and glorify Him with all of our work and, yes, even our homework. I must say, I wouldn't have had this opportunity to be in front of you and encourage you all if my parents didn't believe in me, even when I didn't believe in myself. So I must give credit where it's due. Thank you, Mom and Dad, for encouraging me to continue and finish what I started here at CCC. Thank you, professors, who taught us and took the time and effort to bring us to this point. Ultimately, we want to give thanks to God, because many of us had doubts if we'd get this far. And God used you friends, professors, and families to encourage us to stick it out and finish what was said before us. Thank you.
High school and college. Yeah. With God, all things are possible, right, Joseph? Amen. For our last reflective speaker today is, I asked her, and I felt she needed to do this. And she'll tell you it wasn't an easy decision, but I think it's a decision that's going to unleash a future for her that's got to just be blessed. Will you welcome up here right now, Miss Vanessa?
Thank you all for your support and your prayers. These
2 years at SCCC have not been easy. I have struggled, I have cried, I have failed, and I have succeeded. I have also gone from hating math to now loving it. Math, there's always a solution to a problem. I want to thank all the professors for all your patience and all your willingness to go an extra mile. My experience at CCC has been great, and I'm excited for the next chapter in life. Thank you, Bianca. Every quarter, I will email her. I can't do this. I can't take 3 classes. 4, that's too much. I can't. And she would always reply, you can do it. I know you can. And I did. Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. I never really liked school, and my mom is a witness. I just didn't like school. I didn't want to go to school. College wasn't even an option for me. But God had a future for me. Thank you all, my loved ones, for dealing with me and all my whining with every homework assignment, and for encouraging me to reach my goal. I want to thank my sister, as she's the reason why I started this journey in life. It's such a blessing to be graduating with her. And to my classmates, thank you for pushing me. Melody, every presentation I had, she would be, you can do this. I know you can. You're going to do great. And I'll go up there, and as soon as I was done, and I was about to sit down, she'll be like, you did it. You were awesome. That was the best. But to all my classmates, as Dr. Seuss would say, you're off to great places. Today is your day. Your mountain is waiting, so get on your way. And all the places you'll go. Thank you.
Every mouth will receive.
parents, grandparents, family members, for the time that you've invested into your student here. And we thank you for choosing Community Christian College, for trusting your student with us. And now we've come to the time where we have an opportunity. We had a call about victorious for the class. Color. We couldn't break them apart. But when you hear these two speak, you'll understand why. Our first speaker this morning will be Melanie Schultz. Please come.
Experience of
friends. All of you have inspired and encouraged me as well. I have loved getting to know you, sharing with you in the good times, the challenges, and our growth. I am so proud of you. I hope that as I've shared a little bit about the people who have blessed me, you have called the people who have been there for you. The advice I have for you today, as you make your way in the world to achieve great heights, is to seek out people like these. Seek the people who will encourage you and support you. Surround yourself with people who will push you forward in life and not drag you down. Lastly, I want to encourage you to seek God. Turn to Him for strength, peace, guidance, and love. Be encouraged in Him. Psalm 1:1-2 says, "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night." Today, as we celebrate this milestone achievement, we recall that the Lord not only blessed us with this opportunity to learn, but brought us through to completion. We thank God for this day, for the loved ones and friends who are here to celebrate with us, and for the staff and professors who guided and supported us along the way. Thank you.
Thank you for your wisdom, encouragement, kindness, energy, devotion, and hospitality. I have been spiritually encouraged and refreshed with your uplifting words. Many times you reminded me of important spiritual truths in class. I appreciate the personal touch that each of you have. You have made class interesting and stimulated me with the love to learn. As a class, we are so thankful you and your hard work, your willingness to come and teach late in the evening. You have sacrificed so much time for us. If there is anyone interested in attending CCC, we would love to help in any way we can. For me, it was incredible to be in such a welcoming environment. To all my friends, thank you guys for reaching out to me. It really means a lot. Grammy and Papa, your exhortation is very valuable to me. Grandma and Grandpa, I love you deeply, and I'm appreciative that you are a part of my life. Aunt Dolly, thank you for your chats and for being so interested in my life. To my mom, you are so involved in my life and have faithfully given me wisdom from God's word. Your love and sacrificial heart is inspiring. To Andrew, my brother, my spirits are lifted by your cheerful and energetic spirit. To the class of 2016, thanks for being such kind and fun classmates. God has been gracious, and we did it. But what's next? A lot of us will be doing many different things, but here's something I firmly believe can be an encouragement to us all. Many people have challenged me to worship and thank Jesus throughout the day. As Mrs. Hope says, this involves having a continuous conversation with God throughout the day. We must honor Him for who He is, praise Him, and show respect. The story of God's involvement in the world prompts us to worship Him. God created everything, yet He loves you and me. Humanity has rebelled against God. God is perfect and holy. He has no flaws, and He has never sinned. He hates sin, and He has consequences for sin. Yet he has heard the cry of those who turn to God before it is too late. Jesus died for us to take the punishment for our sins. He did this so we could live with him for eternity and serve him on this earth. The Creator died for his creation. Jesus died for each one of us. Even though we rebelled against him, we can praise and worship God for all his goodness and for all of his justice. Thanking God for everything he has done, even when we are in the midst of a trial, is so uplifting. Isn't it amazing that we have a God who wants us to come to him and have a relationship with him? Not only does he want us to come to him, but he pursues us. We can worship him for his amazing love. If there's anyone here who's never had a relationship with the Lord, you can do it right now. You can decide to turn from your sin and make God your Lord. He will come to live inside of you. If you call out to God, he will answer you. So as we transition into this new stage of life, here are two passages of scripture I would love to share with you guys. 2 Peter 1, 5-11 is a long passage, but to give context, I would like to read the whole thing. And beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue, knowledge, and to knowledge, temperance, and to temperance, patience, and to patience, godliness, and to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind, and cannot see afar off, and has forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. Wherefore the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if ye do these things, ye shall never fall. For so an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's 2 Peter 1, 5-11. My understanding of this passage and the last verse is that we can have an abundant entrance into Jesus' everlasting kingdom if we follow what's in that verse. Living a life consistently growing and obeying God is worth more than everything else. And this abundant entrance is something I think many Christians long for. This passage is important to me because an abundant entrance is something that I want. I hope this encourages and challenges you. Finally, I would like to read Colossians 2, 6-10. As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. For in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and ye are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. This is encouraging because it challenges us to walk connected to Jesus. That way, when we hear doctrine that isn't what the Bible says, we won't follow it. I personally have had conversations with people where they believe in things that are contrary to what the Bible says. This verse has encouraged me to stay connected to Christ and the Bible's doctrine. We will be faced with philosophies and worldviews that will try to deceive us and tempt us to trust in ourselves rather than in God's Word. May we listen to the Holy Spirit and take His boldness so that we can stand strong. There is something that Dr. Avalos has said that has really stayed with me, and I want to share it with you. He said when he wakes up in the morning, he's excited and thanks God for a day to serve Him. His fresh passion each day is incredibly inspiring. As we go our separate ways, I think this mentality will be greatly beneficial. Let's worship God and thank Him for all He has done for us. Thank you.
I think Jonathan was remembering our days after class when we go on. Cold winter night to Derby. Are these wonderful representatives, every one of them has spoken, and there's many who haven't. At this time, I'd like the class of 2017 to stand, please. President Kerensky, the students standing before you have completed the prescribed courses of study in liberal arts. The faculty has certified them as having met the standards required for the associates in arts. There's also some standing here before you, President, today, that will still need to take a few courses but will be done in the conclusion of summer. They too will be honored here with us all. Now, by the authority, President, by the State of California and the trustees of Community Christian College, I hereby confer unto you that these students standing before you have completed the appropriate courses and earned the degree of Associate Arts with all the appropriate rights and privileges and responsibilities. And I welcome you all as now learned men and women. You may be seated.
David Griswold. Yeah!
Jonathan David Russo. Thank you. Joseph Anthony Solon.
Family has established a student support fund, and I have a contribution and a note here I'd like to read, because Bob was involved in so many different lives, but particularly he was involved with Poland Kids, which is a hospital for children. And this note comes from Doug Padgett, who is the president of the Totally Kids, and I just echo what he says. He says, in recognition of the decades of support Bob and Linda Lumley have given towards the mission of both Totally Kids Rehabilitation Hospital and Community Christian College, the owners and management of Totally Kids wish to honor the Lumleys by contributing to a special fund in their name to support students with financial needs to enable them to attend Christian College. And this is a fund that's being established for students who cannot afford to pay all of the fees and so on, and we can help students in this fund. And Doug concludes by saying, may God bless every student who has bestowed a special gift from this fund, and may give tribute to Bob and Linda Lumley through the legacy of prayer and goodwill at their examples to all of us. So I just said thank you for the recognition of the First Congregational Church, recognition of the Lumley family, and all those who contributed to the college, because the result is right here sitting in front of you with all these graduates who are just wonderful graduates, wonderful parents, friends, relatives out here, and this is a God thing, and we just thank you so much for it. So, one other thing that I would like to do, and I'd like to ask if David Zamora would come forward, so that two of David and children were graduates, and David and I have worked together over 10 years, and we have gone through thick and thin, but the Lord has blessed us and helped us maintain this college all the way through, and the thing that has impressed me so much has been the leadership of David Zamora, because he's always been involved not only in what the Lord wants, he loves his family, he loves the college, he loves his church, he loves all of you, but it's not easy sometimes to make all of this happen. And David has been the leader along with Josh to make this happen. But with David, he's a very special person. He's a person who has not had a college degree, but he has innate wisdom. He has judgment that is so sound. He has leadership ability, and he's just built and he's led, and it's just impressed me so much. And one of the things that we would like to do at this point in time is to award to David Zamora an honorary college degree from Community Christian College.
I'm not afraid to die.
quite an experience, I believe, for all of us in family as we've experienced this time. This is an accomplishment. And ultimately, I'm reminded of one passage of scripture from the very start when I was asked to give the charge to you students. The Lord gave me just two verses found in the book of Romans in chapter 12, in verses 1 and 2. Paul, like Jesus and many other of the apostles in scripture, are known for giving charge to the church, to those that are leaders as Christians. But here you guys have accomplished a lot. Your stories are all different backgrounds. And with those stories, there's great testimonies. The Lord has been faithful to you guys all throughout your time in Community Christian College, but ultimately throughout your entire lives. And if it were not for the grace of our Lord, our great God and Savior, to carry you guys through in some of the most difficult seasons in your life, and even at times in CCC. As I look at this crowd, it's interesting because to a degree there's history. For some of you, you're members of the congregation and where I pastor, and I've been privileged to be your senior pastor for several years now. It's not only children, but some of you are, as I can say here, spiritual daughters to me. I've had the privilege to pour into you, not only as a friend, but as a shepherd. Then there are students here that I've known along the way for a period of time. I remember Kelsey Brown when she first sat in my office when I was an admissions counselor at Community Christian College. I remember sharing with her about just CCC and everything, and to see her now here, ready for her next step in life is a great accomplishment. Jonathan, I remember when I first met you and spoke with you and your mother for a period of time, encouraging you to take that step of faith. And no, I remember sitting with you and your father, I recognized him earlier, sitting in the office and you still wondering, do I want to do this? Let me share you guys something. You guys have accomplished a lot. I can say a lot about my children, but I don't want them to be the highlight of this charge. Just like many of you in the times that I've encouraged you to continue to move forward, and sometimes it was just a simple hello after class was over, good night, I'll see you later. But it's been a tremendous blessing to see that I know that you guys have been prayed over on a regular basis. I know the support that me and my wife have put in. My two children could not understand why we made them go to school. And let me say, made them. They didn't have a choice. We made them go to college and high school at the same time. And I remember them being very upset with us, saying, why are you guys doing this to us? But I says, you'll thank us later. And I'm pretty sure that loved ones, family members, closest ones to you all sitting here, graduates, you have the same experiences with them, pushing you and encouraging you. And you know why? Because there was no doubt in their mind that you can do what you've done today. There's never been a doubt in any of their minds that you guys could accomplish what you've accomplished now. Paul the Apostle, in writing to the Romans, says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. It's an interesting term, living sacrifice. Ultimately, sacrifices are to be given up, and they're pretty much as good as dead. But here the Bible speaks of a living sacrifice. This is a continual life. And ultimately, you guys have already sacrificed 2 years of your time at Community Christian College, and your next step in venture in life will require more sacrifice. You see, the service of a Christian, you guys have all accepted Christ as Lord and Savior. And your service as a believer and your life is sacrifice. And ultimately here, when Paul says, I beseech you, he's speaking in an interesting term with I beseech you. It's the word that would be used for one who would give counsel. We're reminded of the Holy Spirit, the counselor. Graduates, understand this, at every step that you take, you should always pray for a fresh work and outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon your life. I'm reminded of what Zechariah the prophet said to a man by the name of Zerubbabel. Zechariah 4:6, he said, it's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, thus saith the Lord. And that's one thing that we pray over you graduates, a fresh work and outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Paul says, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. You see, conformity to the world is really the norm. It's what everybody does, but the believer doesn't. The believer is transformed.
The interesting word here for transform is that beautiful picture that we see there when Jesus was with a couple of his disciples. Remember Peter, James, and John on the Mount of Transfiguration. Jesus transfigured before these disciples, and they saw the glory that nobody else had seen. Ultimately, what Jesus revealed to his disciples there on that mountain is that his greater mission and ministry would represent that which is inside of him. Jesus declared an amazing kingdom that you and I are citizens of. And ultimately, that kingdom was found within Christ Jesus, came forth by the work of the Holy Spirit through the presentation of the gospel, and your lives are to be lived in that very same way. The power of the Holy Spirit resides in each and every one of you today. So as Paul would say, I would say, I beseech you therefore, brethren and sisters, the body of Christ, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as living sacrifices. Take note of this very thing, that many will look at you, and your life will always be a pattern for people to follow. We live in a world of uncertainties that is a reality, and we know for sure that if the world had its way, it would fill us with fear, with failure, with setbacks, and a lot of you can't do it and you can't make it. But I thank the Lord what Jesus prayed in John chapter 17, where he says, Father, they are in this world, but they are not of this world. And though we are in this world, we're not of this world because of who Christ is in each and every one of you. Take what you've learned at Community Christian College, at your churches, from your parents, from the spiritual leaders in your life, and continue to take great steps of faith, because the Lord has greater plans for you. Keep in mind that you'll always keep Jesus at the forefront. He is Lord. He is Savior. And it's by his grace and by his mercy that you guys have accomplished so much. Don't worry about the world. The scriptures have already told us that ultimately one day it'll come to an end. But you and I won't. We will continue to live. We will rule. We'll reign with Christ. And ultimately, keep this in mind. Some have credited this to St. Francis of Assisi, though it has not yet been determined that he quoted this. The statement is, preach the gospel often, and when necessary, use words. May your life be that very thing that others see and say, I don't know what it is, but I want what you have. And your response will always be, Jesus, my great God and Savior. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for these students. I pray, Lord, that as they take steps of faith, Lord, that today, even now, fresh outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon their life, upon their family, upon their friends, so that they would be those that Jesus commissioned as he said, go ye therefore into all the world and make disciples. May they do so. May they teach. May they live out. May they give examples. May they be ultimately, God, what you've called them to be. So, Father, we ask this now in the name that is above every other name, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. God bless you guys.
Class of 2017, you did it, God bless you. Before I give the benediction, I just would like to say one thing. Success is what one can do for self, but significance is what one can do for others. Go out and be significant. Let us bow our heads for prayer. Father God, I thank you so much, Lord, for this opportunity to be before my students, Lord, and their families, and all here to witness them for this momentous occasion, Lord. As we now celebrate them, now being alumni of this great institution, Lord, I just ask that you bless them in each and every milestone after this day, God. Encamp your angels around them, Lord. Lord, let them know that your light drives out darkness, so that each and every step that they take, God, whether it be into the college, career field, vocational, military, whatever their hearts so desire to advance themselves, God, that they remember that the advancement first came from you. So, Lord, as we now just give these students to you, Lord, as they transition into a new part of their lives, help them to know, Lord, that they can do all things through you, but you provide them strength and that if they trust, Lord, and when they trust in you, that they lean not to their own understanding, Lord, but acknowledge you in everything that they do, Lord, that you will direct their paths. So, Lord, as the paths may be far or near, we just ask that you have thine own way in their lives, Lord. And, Lord, just continue to bless them. And I thank you, Lord, for just them allowing us as staff, faculty, board members, all members working together, Lord, to pour into their lives and invest. So as we depart from this place, Lord, have thine own way in their lives, Lord. Now, Lord, I ask if there's anyone under the sound of my voice that does not know you, Lord, that they leave saying, what must I do to be saved? So have thine own way. Touch each and every graduate. Bless them, Lord. Encamp your angels around them. And, Lord, just bless the fellowship that will take place, Lord, that the food that has been prepared, that will be nourishment to our bodies. Lord, I ask for forgiveness of all sins. And I thank you, Lord. And I bless you, and I honor you. And may we all say amen in the name of Jesus.
There's a couple of things before we release you. We do want to get a picture, so after the session, I need your students to come back to the stage so we can get a photograph of all of you together. And I have a couple of individual pictures you want to take for the newspaper as well. So make sure, and then afterwards, family and friends, we have some water and some cookies and some light things. We know that you're probably heading to a good meal, but if you want to take a few minutes and just fellowship together, we have a fellowship room in the back. We invite you to come right after the service. Stand, class of 2017. Just come around, share. May I introduce to you graduating class of Community Christian College for 2017.